Hello guys, my name is Archana Devi. I am assistant professor from Rajagiri School of Engineering, Kochi. This video is part of RSET Online for the subject Computer Graphics, which is an 8th semester global elective. The topic that we are going to deal with today is from module 6. This algorithm, depth buffer algorithm, is one of the visible surface detection methods. So we have already covered one algorithm, backface detection, in the previous lecture. So if you haven't seen that video, I request you to kindly watch that video first and then look into this. So this backface detection algorithm that we have seen, one of the major drawback for that algorithm was, if you have overlapping of objects, that you cannot use that algorithm for eliminating the hidden surfaces. So like for example, if you have overlapping of objects of this way, then the other backface detection doesn't work fine. But the algorithm that we are going to see today, depth buffer algorithm, this works fine even if you have overlapping. Okay, so let's see how this algorithm works, the depth buffer algorithm. So this is one of the image space methods. The visible surface detection methods can be classified either as object space or image space. This is one of the image space method. In image space method, the pixel positions are used to determine whether it falls under visible or not visible. So this depth buffer algorithm is also called as Z buffer algorithm. Okay, because you actually use the Z axis. Along the Z axis, you are calculating the depth of each pixel position. So that's why, hence the name Z buffer algorithm. This is one of the method which is easy to implement. So here what you do is, the surface depth at each pixel position on the projection plane are being compared. Say for example, if you have multiple surfaces like this, you have a surface S1, you have a surface S2, you have a surface S3. So you have multiple surfaces coming, right? So the surface depth at each pixel position. So if you have a pixel position here, what you do is, what is the surface depth for of this pixel position for S1, or for S2 and S3 will be calculated. Okay, from the view plane along the Z axis. So it's measured from view plane along the Z axis. That is very important. So now, after calculating this depth, each surface is processed separately, one point at a time. Okay, each surface will be processed separately, and whichever is closer to the view plane, that depth will be stored. That depth will be stored, and it's at that position, at that pixel position, what is the intensity of that surface, that will also be stored. So if you see that here, S1 is closer, right? S1, you are viewing along the Z axis. So S1 is closer, next comes S2 and S3. So if you are trying to process these three images, then the resultant will be something like this. So S1 is fully visible, S2 is partially visible, right? These portions which are behind S1 is not stored, and S3 also, these portions which are behind S2 and S1 is not stored. Only this part is visible for S3. So we have already seen what visible surface detection is, the definition for visible surface detection. That is, when viewing a picture containing non-transparent objects and surfaces, it is not possible to see those objects from view which are behind the objects closer to the eye. So to get a realistic screen image, removal of these hidden surfaces is must, and identification and removal of hidden surfaces, you call that hidden surface problem. So in the depth buffer algorithm, there will be two cases. The first case is where you are sitting at the positive z-axis and you are viewing along negative z-axis. Okay, so in this Cartesian coordinate system, here there are two surfaces which are there in negative z-axis. So you are sitting in positive z-axis and you are viewing along the negative z-axis. If you view this way, so these are the two surfaces, S1 and S2 are the two surfaces. So which will be closer and which will be farther, that is what you have to determine. So here you can see that for S1, the value will be, say for example, the z value will be, if it is minus 2, for S2, if it is say minus 6. So here you can see that minus 2 is larger than minus 6, but this is closer to the origin, closer to the view plane, right? So the larger values will be closer. If you are sitting at positive z-axis and viewing along negative z-axis, the larger values are going to be closer and the smaller values are going to be farther. Now this is very important. whether we are using along positive z-axis or whether we are using along negative z-axis, depending upon that, you will determine which point is closer to you and which point is farther to you. So similarly, for this case, here you can see that there's a positive z-axis and this is a negative z-axis. So you are sitting at negative z-axis and you are viewing along positive z-axis. That is, the objects are in the positive z-axis. You are sitting here. So when you are sitting here and from the origin, you can see that S1 is near and S2 is farther. So here the value of S2 will be, since it is positive z-axis, say let us see if it is plus 2 and this is plus 6, the value of z value. So here the smaller values are going to be closer and larger values are going to be farther. Okay. So in order to work out this algorithm, you need two buffers. Two memory buffers will be used. The two buffers, you call one of them, you call it as a depth buffer and the other is a refresh buffer. Okay. The two buffers which are used, depth buffer and refresh buffer. So this, the depth buffer stores a depth value for each XY pixel positions as the surfaces are processed. So like it will be a buffer of something of this format, where you have the X and Y values. Say if this is a X value, this is a X values and this is a Y values. So 1, 1, okay, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 3, 4. Say for example, if I have a pixel position X, Y, Z as 1, 2 and 3. So that is at pixel position X, Y, 1, 2, the Z value is 3. So at pixel position 1, 2, right? This is X and this is 2. The pixel value, Z depth value 3 will be stored in this position. That is this depth buffer. Say for example, if I have 2, 2 and then 4, then that means at 2, 2. At 2, 2, the depth value, the Z value is 4. So this is a buffer which stores the depth. Why we store the depth is because we need to compare the depth for each surfaces. So for that, you will store the depth. And the second buffer that you have, you call it as a refresh buffer. The in refresh buffer, what you do is, it will also be similar to this buffer. You store the intensity value for each position. What is the intensity? The RGB component value for each position. So it will also be a buffer of this form, okay, with the XY coordinates. So you have the X and Y coordinate, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. So at pixel position 1, 2, what is the intensity value at 1, 2? That will be stored in this cell. So that is a refresh buffer, just for storing the intensity value for each position. Okay. So here what we do is, we process the surfaces one by one. Each surfaces will be processed in the polygon, listed in the, each surface listed in the polygon table will be processed one by one. In order to calculate the depth, and then one scan line at a time, calculating the depth and at each XY, in order to calculate the depth at each XY. Okay, say for example, if you have these three surfaces, you take each surface one by one, and then for each surface these are the pixel positions, for each of the pixel positions the depth value will be calculated. And depending upon the depth value, which is visible and not will be determined. So let us look at the algorithm for this depth buffer algorithm. Okay, the steps. So what you do is, the depth and refresh buffer that you have to initialize that first. So initialize the depth and refresh buffer for all positions, for all pixel positions, X and Y in the view plane. This is a view plane. So for all XY positions in the view plane, you have to initialize the depth buffer and refresh buffer. So initially the depth buffer is 0. You initialize everything with 0. And for refresh buffer, you initialize with the intensity of the background. Whatever is the intensity of the background in the view plane, that intensity, the pixel value, you are going to store. Okay. So this algorithm here, what you are doing is, you are actually taking the first case. Okay. Out of this, you have two cases. So you are sitting at positive z-axis and you are viewing along negative z-axis. So here larger value are going to be the closer ones, because you are going to get a negative value for z. So larger values are going to be closer and smaller value are going to be farther. So by taking this case, I have written the algorithm. So you can consider both the cases. If you are taking this case, then the condition will flip. That's all. So considering this case, the algorithm has been written. Okay. So the let's look at the algorithm. So initializing the depth buffer and refresh buffer is the first step. Then after that, what you do is you take each position on. So you take each surface one by one. Okay. So arbitrarily the surfaces will be determined by the computer. The computer will take any surface randomly, and for that surface, it will process all the pixel positions. So the surface closest to the plane, you call it as a visible surface. Okay. Then for each pixel position on the polygon surface, compare the depth value to previously stored value in the depth buffer. If the new value, say, if you name it as Z, if the new value is greater than the depth value which is already there in the depth buffer, then you have to replace the new value in that corresponding position. Okay, if the new value is greater. So that is greater means you have to consider this case. Okay, say for example, if this value is already stored, if this value -6 is already stored, you are getting a depth -2. If this value is greater than the value which is already stored, then you have for this pixel position, whatever is a pixel position, if this is a pixel position, for that pixel position, you have to override this -6 with -2. That's what you are doing. Okay. So that is a step that is written here. If the new value is greater, then the current value of depth of XY will change to Z, the new value. And also the intensity of that corresponding pixel position, whatever is the RGB component that you get, that will be stored in the intensity. That intensity value will be stored in the refresh buffer for that pixel position. So you keep on do this for all the surfaces. So for first you take one surface and you do all the steps. And again you take the next surface and you repeat the steps. So what happens is, after all surfaces have been processed, the depth buffer contains depth value for all visible surfaces, and the refresh buffer contains the corresponding intensity value for those surfaces. So what happens if this is a case, if computer randomly takes this surface first, S1, the depth value for these pixel positions, right? The depth value for these pixel positions, everything will be stored in the depth buffer, and the intensity will be of blue color. And then it will process a next surface, which is S2. So S2, initially it all these surfaces is visible, right? So when these overlapping points comes at this pixel position, what happens at this pixel position, this depth value is closer to the origin than this value. So it will be hidden. It will not be stored. So it will go behind the object. So it will process this way. And then finally, the third surface will be taken. So all these parts is hidden. Only this part is visible. So again, the depth value will be compared and only these intensity values will be stored. So the point to be noted here is, this works fine only for objects which are opaque. For transparent objects, this method will not work. Okay, so that we'll see in the next video, how for transparent objects the algorithm will work. So this is the algorithm. So now next we have to find out the depth. How will you find out this Z value? That is our next step. Okay, so let us see how to calculate the depth value. That is a Z value. So in order to calculate the depth value Z, we can consider the plane equation. So you have this plane equation, ax plus by plus cz plus d equal to 0. So z can be calculated as, by rearranging this, you will get z as minus ax minus by minus d by c. So what you can do is, for each pixel position, xy in the view plane, its equivalent z value can be calculated using this formula. So for each xy that you have, you can calculate the its equivalent depth value using this formula. But then this is very time consuming, right? Because you have to substitute the value of z for, you have to substitute the value of x and y and then calculate each z, which is very time consuming. So instead, you can use one step which can be repeated. Recursively, you can do one step. So what can be done is, if you can determine the z value at a pixel position x, y, then we can find this x plus 1 y and then x dash, we'll see what this x dash is, the next value of x and y minus 1. So for x plus 1 y and x, some value of x and then followed by y minus 1, you can easily find out the value if once you have determined the value of z at the position x, y. Okay, so for that, look at this. If this is a polygon that we have, and you have the scan lines, okay, you have to actually process from the top. So this, let us consider this line y, and this is y minus 1. This line is y minus 1, and so you have this point x. Okay, suppose if you have calculated the depth value at this point x y by using this plane equation, by using the plane equation, if you have calculated the depth value at this point, then we can find the z value at x plus 1 y. So this is x plus 1 y, right? This is x plus 1 y. It can be easily found out. And then for this polygon, the next value of x, suppose if this is the next value of x, x dash. So this, for this x dash and y minus 1, you can also calculate the z value. Let us see how to do that. So in order to do that, like for calculating the value at z, x plus 1, you can directly substitute in the plane equation, you substitute x plus 1. So if you substitute x plus 1 instead of x, you will get minus a x plus 1 minus by minus t by c. So if you just expand, you will get minus ax minus a minus by minus d by c. So this can be rewritten as this minus a by c, if you take it outside, minus ax minus by minus d by c minus a by c. So this is nothing but z, right? Z at x position. So this can be rewritten as z minus a by c. So z x plus 1 can be found out as z minus a by c. So this a by c is going to be a constant for you. These are the plane parameters. So once you find z, you can easily find out z x plus 1 by substituting this in this formula. So we have found out what is z x plus 1. So similarly, at z y minus 1, we can also find out z y minus 1. So in order to find out the value of z y minus 1, you need this x dash, right? You need a value for x dash. How will you find the value of x dash? So this is a line in the polygon which is going down, right? Which is going down the line, which is going down the line. So if you calculate, if you consider this line, you can, using the slope, we have the formula for calculating the slope of the equation. So slope of the equation, we have y minus y dash by x minus x dash. That is, this is xy, this point is xy, and this point is x dash y dash. So in order to calculate the slope, you have y minus y dash by x minus x dash. So this is down the line. So y minus y dash is nothing but this point, y minus 1, along the scan line, y minus 1, by x minus x dash, this point x dash. So if you, this is nothing but y minus y, you get cancelled, you have 1 by x minus x dash. So if you rewrite this equation in order to get x dash, you will get x dash as x minus 1 by 1. So down the line, you can calculate the new value of x. Once you know the value of x, the new value of x dash can be found out as x minus 1 by slope. So using this formula, let us try to find out z y minus 1. Okay. So how to calculate z y minus 1? So z y minus 1, again substituting this in the plane equation, you will get minus a, the new value of x dash is x minus 1 by 1, and y is y minus 1, right? For y minus 1 minus d by c. So I've just rearranged this equation, expanded and rearranged this equation. So you will get minus ax plus a by n minus by plus b minus d by c. So interchanging the values, you will get minus ax minus by minus d by c plus a by m plus b by c. So again, this is nothing but your z. So z y minus 1 becomes z plus a by m by plus b by c. This is the value for z y minus 1. Now again, you can simplify this more, because if you are going down the line, right, if you are going down the line, then the slope will become infinity according to the normal slope concept. So therefore the recursive calculation of this recursive calculation will reduce down to, since this becomes zero, so this becomes infinity, that this term goes away, right? A by m goes away. So you will get z y minus 1 as z plus b by c. Okay, so this is how you are calculating the depth value. So why did we find out these two values? We need to calculate the depth value. So rather than calculating the depth value at each pixel position, you can recursively calculate the value at x plus 1 y and another value for x dash and y minus 1 using these two formula. So for z x plus 1, you have this formula, z minus a by c. And for z y minus 1, you have the formula z plus b by c. Okay. So this is a depth buffer algorithm. So now you have, even though it will work fine with overlapping of objects, there are few disadvantages to this method. It requires more memory, and it is because you are using this two buffers, right? Your depth buffer and refresh buffer. So more memory is needed for this. Then this is time consuming, like you are taking each pixel position for each surfaces, so it is more time consuming. Now this is one major drawback. It can only find one visible surface at each pixel position. That is, this will work fine only for opaque surfaces. It will not work fine for transparent surfaces. That is, for example, if you have this object and if you have a transparent object of this form, so what happens is this is one surface and this is one surface. So since the depth value for this object which is behind this scale is more, its depth value will not be stored. The depth value for only this scale will be stored in the depth buffer. And the intensity value will also, the intensity for this part only will be stored in the refresh buffer. But what happens, the intensity value for this object which is behind the scale, you have some few white surfaces coming, right? That is not getting stored in the refresh buffer. So the accumulation of the intensity values is not happening here. So only the intensity, the RGB component for this scale will be stored in the refresh buffer. So this method will not work fine for objects which are transparent. That is another drawback for Z-buffer algorithm. So I hope this concept for Z-buffer algorithm is clear. In the next video, we'll see how can we extend this algorithm in such a way that this will work for transparent surfaces as well. Fine? Okay, thank you.